Hello everybody, welcome back to the Scale Model Medic YouTube channel and the second and final part in my painting and weathering video on the Hasegawa Hitachi Zaxis 135 US excavator. In the first video, I took a huge step outside my military modelling comfort zone to deal with the awkward and complicated build sequence that comes with having such an open and exposed interior. I also had to do a bit of a first, painting such a bright and vivid base colour on a model, and also I had to tackle some areas where there were multiple colours really crammed into a small space. It was actually nice to get onto the weathering, as this felt a lot more like what I was used to. In this video, I'm going to take the model right the way up to completion. I'm going to do some oil staining on the hydraulics, plenty of chipping on the moving areas, as well as some really heavy dust, dirt and mud applications. I've had to leave a few details off until the end of the build to avoid damage, and I'm just going to take a moment now to talk about the kit tracks. Crisp, well moulded and accurate are just a few of the words that will never be used to describe the tracks that come with this kit. These are very crude and very basic tracks, and they don't really look much like the ones on the real vehicle. The connection detail feels very flimsy also, with just two tiny pegs and corresponding holes that require a dab of superglue to join in the middle only. The open sides of the two track links either side of the join are going to pull apart with the tracks under tension, so I'm going to have to position this join on the underside of the kit when I've got them into position. I want to paint them before I put them on so that I can make sure all the inside edges are covered, but they are going to be a pain and I know it, but they're certainly not going to be as bad as those windows with the decals on. So I'm not going to let that hold me back, and instead I'm going to crack on with the video and get this model finished. Starting off with Citadel's Trollslayer Orange, which is what I used as the base colour in part 1, I mixed this with some Citadel Flayed One Flesh, which is a pale beige colour, to create my chipping shade. As I add the Flayed One Flesh to the Trollslayer Orange, you'll see that it does brighten the paint and make it a lighter shade of orange, but that little bit of brown in the beige paint also mutes the colour a little bit as well. If I'd used a white or a yellow, the orange would have gone quite fluorescent, which wouldn't have looked like the reference photos I was referring to, and I basically just mixed the beige in until I had a good approximation of what I was seeing in the real life references. I trawled plant machinery sales websites looking for Zaxis excavators for sale, and I had a look at all the photos, and I decided that I would steal the elements that I liked from all these real life examples and combine them all on my model. To massively increase the risk of dropping the model and destroying it, I precariously mounted it in a Citadel painting handle by stretching the grip over the lug where the upper body meets with the lower running gear. This at least allowed me to hold it while I freehanded on the chips and scratches. Looking at reference photos, a lot of the damage in this area was directional, caused by the body rotating and the corners catching on something. To replicate this, I dragged linear scratches inwards from the outside edges using a beat-up old brush that I wish I'd replaced before I undertook this procedure. I persevered and got a half-decent result in a few areas, and I doubled up the scratches to give them a bit of a bolder appearance. Again, looking at the reference photos, on the big flat areas in the middle, the same directional damage seemed to disappear, so I just added in a few random areas with a few chips and scratches. Here you can see the result of the first layer of the scratches and chips being applied. Overall, I felt that it added a nice dimension, but it needed a second application. I did have to exercise a little bit of restraint as I applied my second layer. It was a nice effect and it did make the model look beat up, but you can see on those reference photos that the vehicles I was looking at just didn't have that much damage. Down at the business end of the excavator, I was able to throw the restraint out of the window and go really heavy with the weathering, as the paintwork in this location on the real vehicle was subject to a lot of abuse. I built up large concentrated areas of chipping mainly on the forward facing areas where the paintwork would have been most exposed to damage, and I did this using a short stabbing motion of the brush to create tighter, rounder chips. I also created some highlights along some of the edges just by dragging the side of the brush along the sharp corners just to give them a bit of a highlight and to create some definition. With the initial chipping layer completed using the pale orange, I then had to fill in the centres of those chips where the rusty metal would have been showing through, and for this I used 71041 Tank Brown from the Vallejo Model Air range. This is a really rich, rusty dark brown shade. It's my go-to colour for this technique, and because it's pre-thinned for the airbrush, it's really easy to work with and it has a long drying time. I started stabbing in the Tank Brown on the centre of the concentrated chipping areas, working my way outwards until only a faint outline of the pale orange chips was left behind. I carried on building up the texture this way using tiny dots of the Vallejo Tank Brown, before again dragging the side of the brush along those sharp corners to increase the definition even further. As I moved away from the more exposed forward facing areas on the vehicle, I tightened up the size of the chipping and I reduced the amount that I was applying, as these areas just wouldn't have picked up quite so much damage. Switching back to the pale orange chipping colour, I started to apply some small localised areas of damage further up the excavator's arm. Looking at my references, these portions of the vehicle just weren't as susceptible to damage as the lower working portions near the bucket, but they did still pick up a few dings and knocks, so I applied the chips with the pale orange, followed by gently brushing in the edges using the Vallejo Tank Brown. This was also a really good way to enhance the detail in this area by giving those edges some stark contrast against the orange base colour. Speaking of the original base colour, I switched back to using some of the Troll Slayer orange and I diluted it and tapped in some chips over the white Hitachi logos just to make it look like they'd flaked off in a few places. With all the chipping completed on the excavator's arm, it was time to add some shading and some oil staining now using these washes from Citadel. Agrax Earthshade is a dark brown wash which I'd use over the orange to represent shadow, and Norn Oil is a black wash which I'd use as the foundation for the oil staining around the hydraulics. Starting with the Agrax Earthshade, anywhere where there was a deep recess in between details, I simply pushed some of the washes in with a fine brush. These are an acrylic wash, so any which gets out of hand will dry permanently, so I kept some water and some tissue on standby just to clean up as I went. Even though it's way more time consuming, I much prefer to apply localised washes rather than bombing it on the whole surface, as I get to maintain control. I work my way around the vehicle, just adding some of the Agrax Earthshade to increase the contrast in the recessed areas. After wetting the surface of the model with some tap water just to keep the blends nice and smooth, I started to apply some Norn Oil in the areas which would have been susceptible to staining from either hydraulic fluid or lubricant leaking out of the joints. By working with a dark acrylic wash over a bright base colour, I knew that I was at risk of getting some tide marks, so to avoid this I kept some water and some tissue on standby and I would clean the brush and feather the edges with the water just to try and keep everything as smooth as possible. A tide mark would really show up over a bright colour like this, so I made it a priority to try and avoid them wherever I could. To complete the chipping and scratching on the rear of the main body, I used Army Painter War Paint Matte Black in exactly the same way that I'd used the Vallejo Tank Brown down by the bucket. Using a bit of a finer brush this time, I followed the lines of the pale orange colour that I'd applied in the first round of chipping, and I tried to leave just a very faint amount of that pale colour showing through to give the scratches some depth. This was a nerve-wracking process, as a mistake at this point could prove very costly, and I would have to mask off and spray again with the Troll Slayer orange, which I wanted to avoid at all costs. The next stage in the weathering was some dust and mud effects, and these were make or break, so I had to do plenty of experimenting first on an old paint mule. I painted it with the same dark grey that I used on the Zaxis, and then I hit it with enamels and pigments in various ways until I settled on one which I actually liked. It took about 3 repaintings with the grey before I hit this effect, but once I did, I knew it was the one I wanted to use. To thin my products on this video, I'll be using Humbrol enamel thinners rather than the odourless stuff I normally use. This actually flows better and seeps into the surface better, so it's more useful for the blends I'm trying to achieve. For enamels, I use Dry Earth Mig 1750 and Turn Dirt Mig 1753, both of which are from the Splashes range. The Splashes range is an enamel paint which is mixed heavily with plaster, so when you do splattering effects with it, it retains some three-dimensional volume. To change the tone of the enamels, I'm going to use Vallejo Pigments Light Ochre, which I used on the interior in part 1, and also Dark Earth from the Humbrol Weathering Powders range, and I'll mix these into the enamel paint as and when required to vary the tone. This is a very limited palette, but that seems to be my way these days, and by mixing these various products together I can achieve a variety of colours. However, I'll also throw in some varnish later on to achieve some wet effects as well. Starting with the turned dirt enamel, I laid out a good amount before thinning it extensively with the Humbrol enamel thinners. I then added a good amount of the dark earth pigment from the Humbrol weathering powders range, stirring the mixture thoroughly to make sure there were no big chunks of the pigments knocking around in the paint. Next up, a good dollop of the Vallejo light yellow ochre pigment was added, and I'm hoping that by keeping this colour in my exterior weathering shades, I can at least get a bit of continuity with the colours I used on the interior. Finally, I lightened the mixture up with just a touch of the dry earth from the Mig Ammo splashes, and then I carried out a quick experiment by splattering and brushing this onto the paint mule. Using the air from the airbrush, I quickly flashed off the enamel thinner to dry the paint up, and overall, I was quite happy that I'd got back to the shade that I first achieved in my experiment, and it was time to crack on with the weathering. Starting on the underside of the running gear, I gave the model a very crude and very loose application of the enamel and pigment mixture. This was an added safety measure as it would give me a chance to check that I really was happy with the shade I'd mixed up, but it also gave me a chance to experiment with the application method that I had in mind. This first layer of the enamel and pigment mixture would work almost like a primer, and the rough application would give me some variation in the strength and the tone of the colour that was going on. Using the airbrush to quickly dry the mixture, I was able to take a look at how this first layer of enamels had gone down. Basically, it looked rubbish. It was blotchy and there were lots of visible brush strokes. However, this was going to play into my hands with the second layer of enamels. This second layer was applied using the speckling technique. I had a small flat brush which I'd cut the bristles down on, and I loaded it up with the mixture before dragging it over the edge of a coffee stirrer to splatter the paint onto the surface in small speckles. By varying the amount of paint on the brush, I'm able to control the size of the speckles which land on the surface, and I built this effect up slowly over the top of that first poorly applied layer of enamel, and then flash dried it with the airbrush again to see how it had finished up. The speckled layer of enamels had gone down a bit like a blending coat when you're doing the black basin on a model aircraft, and it had turned those brush strokes and all that sloppily applied enamel into heavier concentrations of the dust and dirt mixture, which had smoothed out quite nicely. Now, on the lower part of the running gear I was really quite crude and heavy handed. On the upper visible part I wasn't going to be quite so loose with the mixture, but I did blast it on with a large brush and I did allow it to pool in a variety of areas. If I got a concentration which looked unnatural, I'd clean the brush and blend it away. I didn't want it to look too rough. I made sure that all the areas on the lower part of the model were coated with the first layer of the enamels, including the bulldozer blade and all the hydraulics that moved it, and I made sure to get some on the drive sprockets and the idler wheels as well, as these certainly wouldn't have avoided getting dirty. With the first application of enamels dry, I proceeded with the second blending layer using the speckling technique. I allowed some big amounts of paint to hit the surface in some areas, and I reduced it to a mist in other areas. By using Humbrol enamel thinners instead of the odourless stuff, you can see how well it dissolves into the surface, and this is what was helping me get those blends. Using a bit more of the dry earth enamel, I started to vary the shades that I was speckling onto the surface, and I also added some more of the dark earth weathering powder to get some darker speckles going as well. These mixtures were blended in a palette with plenty of the Humbrol enamel thinners to keep it moving and keep it fluid, and I basically just started to get fast and loose with the technique, applying different shades to different areas of the model, not really following any rhyme or reason, but just using them to further blend all of those previously applied enamels together. Using the brighter colours, I was also able to introduce quite a bit of contrast. I started to apply heavier concentrations near the lower portions of the model, where the mud and dirt would have splashed up on the real thing. Once those enamels were dry, I used a little bit of thinners on a fine brush, and I started to introduce a little bit of streaking. For the most part, I tried to keep the streaking to a minimum on the majority of the model, as the surface was already quite busy with all the speckling and I didn't want to wipe it away, as I was quite happy with the way the effect was progressing. However, on the sides of the running gear, where there was constantly water dripping down from the tracks, the effect was quite pronounced on reference photos of the real thing, so I worked the streaking effect in this area quite extensively. I also wanted to bring some of the dark grey through from underneath to enhance the contrast, so I started using a cotton bud to remove larger amounts of the enamels. Once I was finished, I was really quite happy with the effect, so I moved on. Once the enamels had been allowed to fully cure, I sealed everything with quite a rough layer of Mig Ammo matte varnish. I almost deliberately made this a rough application so that it was nice and porous and I could use it as an anchor point for a further application of enamels later on when I went in with the mud effects. But for now, it was time to move on to the dust on the upper portion of the model. I switched back to using the odourless enamel thinners from Mig, as this is softer than the Humbrol stuff and posed less risk of damaging the paint, and I thinned down some of the turned dirt and dry earth before allowing it to settle in the pot so the plaster would fall to the bottom, and I transferred the liquid portion of the mix into the Infinity 2-in-1 and turned the pressure down with my air control valve. I needed to apply a very light coat of this mixture and allow it to build up gradually, giving the impression of dust that settled on the surface of the vehicle. Starting with the underside of the model just as a test area, I airbrushed on the enamel mixture and checked how it would dry. I was happy with the effect, so I carried on and applied the dust to the rest of the vehicle. I started near the lower edges, as this would have been where the dust concentrated heaviest, and I worked my way upwards in a smooth gradient. On the flat surfaces on the top of the vehicle, I gave it a nice even coat as the dust would have settled quite uniformly. I had to make sure I got in amongst all of those nooks and crannies to give it a nice even coat, and on the windscreen I'd also masked off the sweep of the wiper blade so this would leave a clear area with a nice defined edge. Even though it was a bit of a gamble to airbrush a paint which contains plaster, by allowing it to settle in the mixing pot it did airbrush on smoothly, and I suspect that some really fine particles of plaster were still present, as when it dried it had this really dry and grainy effect which was exactly what I was hoping to achieve. The thin application allowed the chipping and scratches weathering underneath to show through, and overall I was really quite pleased that my experimental use of the splashes paint had paid off. As a finishing touch with the dust effects, I decided to flow some of the mixture into the recessed details in a few areas just to provide some contrast and help the details stand out. While I was doing this on the steps on the front of the model, I got a nice big blob of enamel right on that dust effect I just airbrushed on. When I noticed it, I was absolutely furious and I had to try and clean it off and then reapply the dust with the airbrush. Even though I tried to mask it with further weathering later on, the whole area now sort of felt tainted to me and I was kicking myself for making such a huge mistake, but I've had to just deal with it and move on. I concentrated some dust on the arm of the excavator, focusing mainly down low by the bucket, as these vehicles are really quite high and I don't think the dust would settle up top very much, before going ahead with a second application of enamel, this time using the speckling effect again. This I kept very concentrated and I only worked right down low just to provide some texture to that dust coat. It was time for some more oil staining over the top of the dust, so I placed a nice big blob of lamp black oil paint on some cardboard and then I used this to make some nice blends in these areas where oil or lubricant would seep out into the dust on the surface of the vehicle. By placing the oil paint on cardboard first, this actually draws the oil out of the paint and keeps the mixture quite stiff and dry. This is great because it allows me to then grind it into the surface neat and then work the paint outwards to create a blend. I'd applied the same effect around those areas which I treated with the Nuln oil wash earlier, before adding some gloss coat into a mixture with some Humbrol enamel thinners to create a bit of a shiny black wash. I flowed this around the sources of the leaks, and even though there was too much thinners for it to dry truly glossy, it would still catch the light enough to give the impression that some areas were still quite damp. Before moving on to the mud on the running gear, I went back over a few areas using dark earth from the Humbrol weathering powders range, just to work in a slightly different tone and break up that monotone appearance in the dust shade. It was time to start adding some mud to the running gear. I needed to keep the colours consistent with the rest of the weathering, so the main component would be turned dirt from the Mig Ammo Splashes range, along with the Dark Earth weathering powder from Humbrol. To try and recreate the effects I'd seen in these reference photos, I needed something to add some volume and texture, so I piled a load of the Flat Earth pigment into the Vallejo acrylic thick mud paste that I showed recently in the King Tiger video, and stirred it up before grinding the coarse granules once it had dried. Alongside this, I was going to add some ordinary sand in there as a bit of a filler, just to try and bulk everything up. I started off using the turned dirt enamel, and into this I mixed a good dollop of the dry earth shade, but I didn't fully mix these paints on the palette, and I allowed some of the original paint to remain so I could blend this in later on to vary the colour as I went along. I didn't bother thinning this as I needed it to act as a fixer for the thicker textured elements, and I just started to dab in a bit of a layer where I wanted the mud to accumulate. Using the tip of a large flat brush, I started to pick up some of the small to medium sized chunks from my acrylic paste and weathering powder mixture, and I tapped them into the surface so they gripped onto the wet enamel paint. Once I'd built up a nice layer, I added some enamel thinners into the enamel paint and flowed this in between those chunks of acrylic paste. This would hopefully give a good grip and keep everything in place once it dried. To avoid the mud layer looking like it was just sitting on top of the existing weathering, I used the leftover enamel paint to generate some more streaks and hopefully key those two layers together nicely. In this zoomed in part of the footage, you should be able to see the effect taking shape a little bit clearer. I started yet again by tapping in the larger chunks into the wet enamel fixer, and I also added a few bits of the Dark Earth weathering powder as well just to vary the tone, and I built up the effect gradually before bringing down some more streaks over the top of the existing weathering, hopefully just to key those two layers together and make everything look a little bit more natural. I added yet another layer of speckling over the top of the mud layer, just to try and further blend this into the existing weathering, before allowing it to dry fully over a couple of days and then assessing the effect and how it had built up. I was really happy with the way the mud was progressing, and I was happy with the texture and the tone. All of the colours were consistent. However, after testing it with the tracks, it became apparent that I hadn't gone quite far enough forward with the mud layer, and I needed to extend this outwards in order to be visible on the finished model. I repeated the mud application process in a very tight, controlled strip running alongside the edge of the previously applied mud. I didn't want to overlap with that previous application, because if you remember the reference photos I showed you, there wasn't that much dried mud sitting on top of the running gear, and I wasn't trying to represent a really dirty vehicle. By working in a tight strip alongside that front edge, I was able to minimise the overlap, and the only time I really did go over that previous application of the mud was when I flowed in the fixer, just to make sure that the colour was consistent and this looked like one solid layer. I started to bring the dried mud weathering right down onto that front face now by mixing in some sand alongside the enamel paint and those acrylic chunks, and then tapping this mixture on into a few key areas. Because I'd added so much sand, the texture of the mixture had turned into a kind of sludge, and I was able to manipulate this well with a fine brush and build up the concentrations just where I wanted them. I added a couple of spots of different colour by blending in some light yellow ochre pigments from Vallejo. This was just to try and give the appearance that the same dirt was present on the outside of the vehicle as was present on the interior that I'd done in part one. I mixed up a sludge using sand, turned dirt enamel and dark earth weathering powders, and I started to pile this into some of the harder to reach areas using a fine brush. This was to represent dirt and mud which had fallen down into these crevices and built up over time. I extended the application of the mud mixture to the lower edges of the bulldozer blade assembly, and I also added a bit of an accumulation on these horizontal ledges behind the blade itself. Even though the excavator's bucket was most likely to be left empty when the vehicle was at rest, I decided to pile in some of the acrylic paste and weathering powder chunks anyway, just because I'd enjoyed using the effect so much on the running gear, and it would also provide yet more of that colour continuity I was going for on the weathering. I flowed plenty of enamel into this to act as a fixer, before also tapping in some of the light yellow ochre from Vallejo, again just trying to get the colours to carry through from the interior weathering. To tie all the effects together, I applied a thin layer of the fixing enamel around the outside of the soil and then feathered the edges with Humbrol enamel thinners just to blend everything together. I then used matte coat as a final sealant to hold it all in place. I diluted some Humbrol satin coat with enamel thinners and then used this to create some damp areas on the outside of the bucket. This would darken the existing weathering and give it a little bit of a sheen and make it look like it had been cutting through wet earth quite recently. I applied this in a loose fashion and allowed the seeping action of the enamel thinners to just bring it into that dust layer I'd sprayed on previously. I also repeated the application on the inside of the bucket, again just to make it look recently used. The tracks were then glued together and given a good coat of UMP grey primer. I chose grey because I was skipping straight to the weathering. These would be so dirty there was no need for a base coat. And as with all the other weathering on the vehicle, I used turned dirt and dry earth from Mig splashes and it was all darkened with dark earth weathering powder from Humbrol. This was all mixed together in one pot to give me a nice dark brown shade and then painted on in a good thick layer straight over the primer. I made sure to cover all the guide horns and I tried to avoid any gaps. Once these tracks were in position, I didn't want to have to try and get a brush in between any of the existing weathering to fill in any areas I'd missed. After siphoning off some of the dark brown mixture, I introduced a good amount of the dry earth shade to give me a lighter colour, and then I painted this over the dark brown while it was still wet, but just along the outside edge of the tracks. This would represent the more exposed part of the tracks where the dirt and mud would start to dry first. And because I'd painted it wet on wet, I was able to blend the two colours easily just by cleaning the brush and then manipulating the paint with the tip. To avoid this effect looking too uniform, I took some of the Humbrol dark earth powder and I blended this into the enamels while they were still wet. After flipping the tracks over, I painted in the reverse faces of all those guide horns before repeating the process with the light and dark enamels and blending in that lighter outer edge. I then carefully went around the tracks and hunted down any gaps where I might have left the primer showing through, and I painted these in before stretching the tracks into place on the model. Straight away, you can see that there's no sag in the top run, and also the way they sit, there's this big gap at the bottom as well. The weight of the model would at least fix that, but there's no way of replicating the sag on the top. These really are a letdown in what is otherwise a fantastic kit. Using the same light and dark brown mixture that I used on the inside face of the tracks, I started to block in the outside face. This layer was going to function much like that first layer of enamels way back when I started the lower running gear, almost like a weathering primer, and I just used the shades to block in the colour very roughly before proceeding on to the next step. With the brown enamels now dry, I used Mr. Metal Colour Aluminium to dry brush the tracks and highlight those raised edges on the track links. This was taken from yet another reference photo, which showed the metal of the tracks visible even under really heavy weathering. With that done, it was time to grab those familiar weathering products yet again and do another mud application. I started out with a good dollop of matte coat, and into this I put some of the turned dirt enamel, followed by an absolutely huge amount of the dark earth weathering powder. This started to form up into a thick paste, but it still wouldn't have the volume I needed to do the packed mud application around the outside of the tracks. So I started to add sand to the mixture, and this soaked up the enamel thirstily until it formed into a really heavy sludge. With the matte coat in there, it would grip onto the tracks and dry nice and flat. And here you can see the consistency that I started to work with. Using a very fine brush, I started to pack the mud mixture into the recessed areas on all the track links. As you can imagine, this is a very time-consuming and manual process, but it does allow me to retain control over how much mud I'm adding and where it's going. I can also build up the texture or leave certain areas bare to break up the finish, and more importantly, it allowed me to avoid those metallic highlights that I'd dry brushed on. If I'd gone ahead and slapped this mix on with a big brush, I just wouldn't be able to get that effect showing through. I recently used this technique on the King Tiger video, so as you can imagine, I was very grateful to have such a small subject to work on, but even so, it still did take ages. Using the same mixture, I started to replicate the accumulations of mud you can see in the reference photos along the inside face of the guide horns, which is obviously falling down from the tracks above. On its way down, some of it clips the suspension housing, so I put some little blobs of the mixture in there as well, just to represent the most recent dirt that had fallen down. Because of the amount of matte coat I'd used in the mud mixture, it dried completely flat and even, whereas I wanted some of the mud to still look fresh and still be damp. So I diluted some satin coat and I started to soak this into the packed mud effect. I didn't just limit this to the outside of the tracks, but I also applied it to all the more recent lumps that I'd added to the outside of the suspension. This little bit of satin finish darkened the weathering and gave it a little bit of a sheen, indicating that there was still some moisture there. I started to introduce a few streaks with the satin coat, just to give the impression of water running down over an otherwise dry vehicle. I expanded on the application of the satin varnish and started to build up some areas where the moisture had seeped into the surrounding dust. I added more runs, some of them being quite big and prominent, and I really liked the way they'd break up some otherwise featureless areas. With the satin varnish applied, that was the last step in the weathering, and I realised I'd taken it as far as I wanted to go. I glued on the handrail next to the steps and the driver's door, plus a few other small parts, including the wiper, and basically the model was finished. Unfortunately, I don't have a fancy automatic turntable to put it on to show you, but I hope you get the impression. I'll roll some better pictures at the end of the video. All in all, I'm really happy with the finish that I achieved. I pushed myself out of my comfort zone with a weird build sequence, loads of different techniques, and even though I kept my palette limited, I feel like I built up some quite good textures and I managed to get some pretty realistic weathering. That mistake on the outside of the body still bugs me and I'll never be happy with it, but the weathering on the bucket and the running gear counteracts this, as I feel like it's some of my best work to date. I was really happy with the finish I got in those areas. One thing that I may do at a later date would be to just add a little bit of light yellow ochre pigment along the bottom of the driver's door to tie it to the weathering on the interior, but at this stage I've spent many hours doing the mud and dirt weathering on the tracks and I'm a little bit burned out on this project, so I've decided to call it finished and just leave it alone. Some of the weathering that went on can't be seen, it's tucked away at the back here in this big dark area. However, I know it's there and it got me some good footage for the channel, so I'm really quite happy. One thing I did off camera which I haven't shown you was just to wipe away some of the dust on the rear window to try and give the impression that a driver had cleaned this away, enabling them to see at the back of the vehicle. I think this combined with the wiper sweep on the front window gives it a bit of a lived in look and makes it look that little bit more realistic. And that's it, the Hitachi Zaxis 135US is now complete. A nice quick two-part video series, and hopefully the first of many this year as I aim to fill the channel up with loads of new content. I hope you've enjoyed watching these videos, and I hope you'll continue to support my channel by hitting the subscribe button, and maybe giving these videos a share onto one of the Facebook pages that you use. I really would like to try and generate some more traffic on the channel and get it back to its former glory. So if you wouldn't mind sharing it, I'd really appreciate it. And also, please drop me a comment below and just talk to me. I really like interacting with the guys who watch the channel, and I like to hear about what my videos have done for your hobby, if anything at all. Even if you've just got a suggestion about something I might do better, I try my best to reply to all comments. I've got a bit of thinking to do now about what project to add to the channel next. But whatever it is, I hope to get it online very shortly. As always, everyone, thanks very much for watching, and I'll see you again next time.